Hey everybody, I hope you're doing well. Did you know that companies will sometimes throw out perfectly working hardware? For example, this laptop right here was about to be in the trash before I rescued it. And I thought that this would be a great opportunity for me to show what you can do with older hardware that you may not be able to use day to day. And we're gonna be rescuing this laptop. It's at the moment unusable, but we're gonna rescue it. We're gonna install a Linux operating system, and then we're going to be making it into a home server because it is really efficient. And it has its own battery backup that still works. So this is the perfect home server. This is gonna be a great opportunity for you and me. So let's get started. Let's give it a little wipe. Okay, so now that we wiped it down, the first thing that I wanna do is see what kind of inputs and outputs we have. Okay, so this appears to be the proprietary port that Lenovo likes to use in some of their laptops and efficient ThinkCenter computers. We have a USB 3, we have a SD card reader, a full SD card reader. We seem to have a mini HDMI, or is there a micro HDMI? I can't tell the difference. I think this is a micro HDMI. In the back, there is nothing. And then on the other side, we have another USB port. It's not color coded, so I assume this is USB 2.0. Headphone and microphone combo jack. Volume up and volume down. I'm not sure what this one is, maybe a lock button. And then two more buttons, one for power. And I think this may be an indicator. Oh, it is a button. I'm not sure what it does, but it's really hard to hit. I can't hit it unless like I put my nail up there. And then in the front, there is nothing. Okay, so now that we know what we're working with in terms of inputs and outputs, let's open it up. The keyboard appears to be pretty solid. It feels brand new. I don't see any scratching or anything inside of the lid. The screen seems to have a thicker bezel and it does fold all the way back. So this is a two-in-one device, which is good, I guess. Okay, so now that we've taken a look in the outside, let's take a look in the inside to see what we're working with. The cover is coming off. Oh, it's a little bit hard. Okay, I don't see anything in the cover of interest, so let's put on to the side. This has a pretty big battery for its size. The RAM is soldered on, so you can't add more RAM. See, this is why a lot of people don't like solder RAM, because this laptop is from a couple of years ago and you can't upgrade it, not even one bit. It seems to have a physical hard drive, so we're gonna take that out and change it. But aside from that, everything seems pretty standard. Seems like the CPU is in the other side. It's one of those weird laptops where the CPU is underneath the keyboard, and a subwoofer. Now that we know what we got more or less, we know that we can upgrade the hard drive. I have this Kingston SATA SSD laying around, so I'm gonna be adding that to this. So the reason I'm putting an SSD in it is because just changing the SSD is gonna make the most difference in terms of user experience. These hard drives, not only are they more prone to failure because they're mechanical hard drives, but they're really slow, and with time, they just get slower. So if you have a laptop, just changing the hard drive for a solid state drive, it's gonna be a huge upgrade. And SSDs have come down in price. I know that right now there's inflationary pressure on the SSD market and they come up in price a little bit, but it's still worth it. You know, this is a 480 gigabyte SSD, and it cost me when I bought it like $30. Right now they're probably 40 or 50, which is still cheaper than buying a whole new device. So we're gonna be adding this to this. This hard drive was a 500 gigabyte Seagate laptop ultra slim hard drive. Now let's add the SSD. I replaced the hard drive. Finally, another thing that I forgot to mention is that this thing appears to be fanless, which is insane. Or maybe the fan lives in here somewhere. I don't know. This is a fanless system. Now, I'm just realizing that right now. But it has a cutout here. So how can it be fanless, but still have a cutout for a fan? I'm actually curious now. Where is the fan hiding? I don't know. Now I'm curious, because it does have a CPU. Oh well, maybe it is a fanless system. Okay, so the lid is back on. Now, since we're going to be installing a brand new operating system, we are going to need a USB flash drive and a way to get this USB flash drive to boot, to become a bootable flash drive. Now, for this, we are going to be using this side computer that I am using for this. Let me move the camera. Okay, so I repositioned the camera so that you can see the screen of this laptop. We're going to take this flash drive, which is going to be our bootable flash drive, and we're going to be plugging it via the USB port. So it did recognize it. However, here's the thing, right? In order for you to make the USB installable, you should go to Belina Etcher. This is the website for it. Let me make it a little bit more zoomed in. And you can download this software. It is available for all three platforms if you want. However, because this is a Linux machine, what I'm going to be doing is I'm going to be using EDI, which comes with this PopOS installation. Hey, editor here. So I made a mistake. I said that I was going to be using EDI for flashing the ISO operating system into the USB, but this is the incorrect program. What I meant to say was Popsicle, which comes with Pop OS, and it allows you to flash USB flash drives with an ISO image, making them bootable. When it comes to the actual Linux software, I am going to be recommending Linux Mint. Linux Mint is really familiar. It's not overwhelming. When you go here to the download option, you're gonna see that there's a bunch of different options. You have something called Cinnamon Edition, Mate Edition, XFCE edition. All of that, what that means is that the desktop environment is different. Now, if you don't know what a desktop environment is, it's basically the look and feel of the operating system. Like in the core is running Ubuntu, but then like the way it looks is different. So we're going to be downloading the Cinnamon edition. It downloaded finally. So let's open it up in the files. And with Pop OS, which is what I'm running in this laptop, I double click on it. It opens up Popsicle to make it bootable. So click next. And we're going to be choosing the USB. And now it's going to be installing Linux Mint to the USB flash drive, which will make it bootable. Let's connect the flash drive. Let's connect power. So we're now getting power. Let's open the laptop. Let me turn this light off for clarity. And let's hit F12. So it gives us the boot option for Linux Mint. Okay, so now there's the Linux Mint logo. It's hard to see the iPhone. The iPhone doesn't want to adjust the brightness. Can you see it? Yep, so that's the Linux Mint logo. So that's a good sign. Oh, I heard a noise. And we're into the Linux Mint operating system. Finally, okay. Now, this laptop appears to be touch. Let's see if it's true. Yes, it is. It's a touch-enabled laptop. But because we're going to be using it as a server, we don't really care about the touch functionality. If you wanted to do touch stuff, I would recommend a GNOME-based Linux desktop environment, like probably Pop OS or Ubuntu itself. So now that we're booted into the bootable flash drive, let's go here and install Linux Mint. Okay, so it finally opened up the install menu. Okay, so the iPhone is adjusting. I hope you can see this. We're going to be selecting English as our operating system language. Continue. For our keyboard, let's just keep it at English US. Continue. Here, it's giving us the option to connect to Wi-Fi. We're not going to do that at the moment. Okay, so it's giving us the options that we want to install multimedia codecs. No, let's just keep it. Let's continue. Let's keep it as is. You can always install it later. Okay, so here it hasn't detected an operating system, so we will want to erase the entire disk. So let's do install now. Now we're getting a warning. It will delete everything. It will destroy all data. I'm just going to click continue. It's going to ask us to set our locale. I am in New York, so continue. It's going to ask us to set the credentials. So for this, we're going to be using code fallacy. The host name, I'm just going to say Lenovo. And for the username, and then for the password, it's just going to be code fallacy as well. Other than the speed, the installation instructions are pretty straightforward, so I'm really happy with the minimal things that we have to do to get this going. And now it is installing the operating system, and this is what could take a couple of minutes. Okay, so the installation is complete. It's kind of hard to see, but now what we need to do is power off the device and remove the USB stick. So let's close this. Let's go here and then let's just power off. Yeah, just shut down. Yes, I would like to shut down the system. Okay, so it's telling us to remove the installation medium, and then we have removed it. Now we hit enter. And now let's reboot by pressing the power button. We have the Linux Mint logo. Okay, so it booted. It's a lot faster than it used to be. So let's just type our password. And now we are into the desktop, and now it's a lot more responsive than it used to be before. So let's add the Wi-Fi connection. So let's go over here to the lower right-hand corner and click, select our Wi-Fi, and add our password. Connect. Now we are connected to Wi-Fi and we got the notification. This is one of the reasons I recommend Linux Mint for Windows users, because this feels like Windows 7. Not even Windows 10, just straight up Windows 7. You have your start menu, you have a bunch of applications, and it's all pretty straightforward. You have accessories, you have Office apps. Linux Mint comes pre-installed with LibreOffice, as many distros do. You have Firefox as your default browser, comes with Thunderbird for emails, and is pretty straightforward. But if we go to the start menu and just type update, there is a software sources, and then there's a update manager. You don't have to use the terminal for anything. This is the update manager. Just click OK. It is now refreshing the app list to see what needs to be updated and what doesn't. Okay, so after hitting refresh the second time, I guess by default, it didn't detect that there was an update, but now it says that there's a new version available. So apply the update. And just like that, you're keeping your system up to date. It's asking us for our password. And just like that, we have a laptop with a pretty versatile operating system. Hey everybody, so it's the next day. I'm editing the video and it turned out that the video was a lot longer than I expected or that I wanted to be. So what I'm doing here is I'm just gonna tell you what I ended up cutting out. I ended up cutting out how you're able to use the function keys normally. Like for example, you can still use volume up and volume down. You're not losing that functionality. Also, there's a software store through FlatHub. You're able to install programs without needing to use the terminal. And this is a pretty stable device. And I think that somebody who may only use the browser is able to use this device. It's pretty efficient. It's only using like 800 megabytes for the operating system. So you're still able to run some pretty decent programs in it. And this is a great functioning device that should not have been thrown away, but rather given another purpose. Now, even though I installed Linux Mint, which is a desktop operating system, we're going to be using Docker. All the programs that I've shown you how to run up to this point, we're gonna be running it on this device because this device is just as efficient as the Raspberry Pi 5 and maybe, just maybe a little bit more powerful. Now, this particular device is really old and it's only got 4 gigabytes of RAM, but you can get a similar device from that same era, which is substantially more powerful. And I just want you to know that this is going to be another device in our tool shed that we can use for hosting services. So stick around, and moving forward, I may be able to show Raspberry Pi 5 content, or I may be able to show it on this computer. So subscribe, and if you found anything in this video helpful, give it a like, and see you next time.